Right, hello. This is a race car, literally. There's no two ways about this video. We're gonna get straight into it. This is the new KTM Crossbow GTXR. So KTM, you guys all know, very popular in the bike world, but then made the first car in 2008. Very successful in racing. Actually, the base of this car, or literally this car, was successful in GT2. And then they decided, you know what, why don't we make this into a road-going version? And they've done just that by effectively changing almost nothing. And I've just, you know, I've had this for the last 2 days, been driving around with it, and figured it was probably about time to make a video for you guys. It's been an amazing time that I spent with it, and honestly I've kind of completely fallen in love with this car, so I wanted to show you around, give you a tour, and yeah, so let's look around the exterior. First things first, this one is in a beautiful green carbon fiber spec. So the car, you can choose to have it with exposed carbon fiber or not. It's a fairly pricey option, but compared to other manufacturers that will do full carbon fiber options, it's about a quarter of the price of other manufacturers who will do this as an option. So here you're talking around 35,000 to 40,000 euros to do a full carbon fiber car, whereas, you know, if you go McLaren or Bugatti or whatever it may be, you're then in the hundreds of thousands. Yeah, so that's for the exterior. The whole car obviously is carbon fiber purely for weight. 1130 kilos for the car dry. It does have a 96 liter tank, however, so quite a lot of weight that comes with that, but the tank is, you know, low for the center of gravity, and we'll talk about the center of gravity further on in the video because there's a lot of different aspects to that. They've obviously thought about everything, this being a race car effectively. So yeah, 1130 kilos, 500 horsepower. We'll talk about that. I'll show you the engine afterwards because a lot of you maybe will recognize the engine. The only thing basically that you have that's not carbon fiber is the steel tube frame of this car, which is there to basically link the engine and everything to the monocoque. You have a carbon fiber monocoque in this, which if I open it up, you'll be able to see. Now the carbon fiber monocoque weighs 89 kilos, and with carbon fiber monocoques, basically what it means is they will come up quite high on the side and you need to be cocooned as much as possible into it. So it's quite hard obviously to put doors in the side of that because it will weaken the monocoque. And the whole point of a monocoque is for it to be stiff, light, sturdy, safe. So if you put doors in the side of it, bit of an issue. So KTM have come up with this solution to do what they call a canopy, which is effectively the coolest door in the world, which you action from the key here. The whole front canopy, if you come around this side a little bit, you'll be able to see the whole front canopy here lift up. This is all carbon fiber as well, and shows you this pretty stunning interior, which is also all carbon fiber. And so this is your monocoque. Okay, we're gonna need to move because we're blocking a bit here, but look, starting it up, again, same classic kind of Audi functions here. Sounds good, you'll see when we're driving the sound of it. Steering wheel comes to life, and now I close my canopy and let's go for a drive. Bye-bye. Pretty cool that.
Here we go, guys. So, it is, of course, a harness, as you saw in here. So straight into sport mode, so it's a bit confusing because there is no normal comfort mode in this car because the car doesn't really do normal or comfort. So we're going straight into sport out of what's called performance mode. The dash goes, basically it just gives you your gear in a lot bigger and your speed goes smaller because when you're on track, you don't really need to know what speed you're doing. It's kind of irrelevant. What you want to know is your revs and what gear you're in. Then push it to the right and you're into manual mode. And off you go. Steering wheel's already indicates on the steering wheel right here. And it just, yeah, there's no kind of race clutch off the line or anything like that. Because it's a car that's gonna be used on the road, you have that 7-speed Audi DSG gearbox. So yeah, I mean, it's an engine and a gearbox which are built to be driven on the road. They just happen to be plopped into a race car. Now listen to this. When you change gear, that sound is so satisfying. I have never held in my hands a steering wheel that gives you as much satisfaction as this one. Full carbon fiber, the Alcantara, the way the action on the paddles is just amazing. And even the buttons that you press, just everything feels quality and it feels like a race car where it's like It's quality because it has to be, if that makes sense. It's all there so you can press it with gloves and it gives you proper feedback, so you properly have to press it to do it, so you don't press it by accident on track. Now, we're gonna be battling a bit with the sun on this video because we have the low winter sun, which is a bit tricky, and you don't really have many sun visors and things like that in this, so the cameras may be readjusting at certain moments to the sun, so I do apologize in advance if that does happen. As soon as you hop in, first thing that strikes you is you're kind of like sat on the front wheels in this, right? The engine's quite far back for that weight distribution, and as we said, it's even actually put off slightly to the right for the driver. Not that I weigh much, so it's not gonna make too much of a difference for me. So you notice that, but what that means is with this big windscreen in front of you, the visibility is actually pretty amazing, especially out front. Now, the cameras, so that your visibility out back and off to the sides, take some getting used to. So when you first hop in, it doesn't induce confidence instantly, but then once you get used to it, it's okay. So you have two cameras, obviously one on each side, and then you have the middle camera, right? And honestly, driving through town, yeah, you need to spend a little bit of time with this before it properly induces confidence. But then once you've done it, it's okay. Now, speed bump. So we're about to go into the village, and then we'll properly get on it a little later on. So let's go back into performance mode, right? So this is your street mode. So this is, I'm either heading to or back from a racetrack, and I'm not gonna put the car on a trailer. I decided to take it myself. Now, speed bumps, you can go over them, as you can see here. You need to slow down quite a bit, and there will be a lift option for this car. It's just being homologated right now. So this being one of the early cars, I believe the 11th car produced, we don't yet have the lift. But when you do, then the car, honestly, I mean, we're driving it around without a lift and haven't had any issues thus far, touch wood. So I imagine with a lift, it will be, you know, perfectly good, as usable. It's not the first adjective I thought I would be using to describe this car, but hey ho, so be it. So when you go through, the steering is quite nice and light, and you know, it's still very precise even in performance mode like this. The exhaust kind of quiets down a little bit, but even when you're accelerating hard, you don't really hear exhaust per se. What you hear is all the mechanical sounds, and you'll hear it when we accelerate a bit more. It's really satisfying because you're just hearing gear shift, you're hearing lift off from the turbos, you're hearing the mechanics of the engine, and it's not like force induced fake exhaust sound. And this five cylinder, I'm sure you guys know, has quite a particular and recognizable sound. So there are other cars, you know, which are very race focused, but will often use, you know, a smaller four cylinder, less characterful engine than this. And that's one of the things that I've enjoyed a lot, is the character that you find in this engine is pretty special. So yeah, driving through town like this, as you can tell, I mean, it's obviously very different and very particular, but I don't know, somehow it's not as intimidating or terrifying as I expected. The first 5 minutes are pretty intimidating, but that's mainly because of the drama of everything, like the door, getting into it and feeling cocooned in this monocoque. But then once you've kind of gotten past that and you get to the reality of what it's actually like to drive it, yeah, then it suddenly, yeah, it kind of welcomes you in here, and it's almost like that, I don't know, that big brother that looks really intimidating at first, and you think like, oh, this guy's gonna bully me or whatever, and then ends up being a bit of a big teddy bear and being nice to you. It's a bit of that. So you see it, you're like, oh, what have I signed up for here? And then you get into it and you're like, oh, actually, the seats are surprisingly comfortable, dare I say it. I mean, it's not in any way a long distance cruiser you're gonna go crunch miles in, of course. But the seats, you know, they don't feel like you're just sat on a skateboard. However, you do feel all the little vibrations. I don't know if it will come off on camera here, but like the steering wheel, when you let go at idle like this, everything starts to shake. And it's the same thing that I can feel in my back right now. Because I'm literally sat on the monocoque, I feel everything that's going on. And then when we start pushing on it, that's what makes this car so special. So right now we're stuck in traffic, but actually while we're here, I can just show you also a few things like the light controls, which I hear you obviously have the quad lock which charges your phone when you put this on, and these buttons that you can do with the with your gloves, which is well thought out. I mean, that shows kind of where KTM were thinking with this car. And then the steering wheel, where you have all sorts of different buttons, and it is very, very race car like. Oh, we just missed the green light, and there is a police car in front of us, so probably wisest that we don't go past this. So we're about to get onto the exciting roads. So, into sport. Don't know if you could hear that. It like slightly pops into, you hear the revs, the idle goes up slightly, the exhaust opens up ever so slightly. We'll go into manual mode. And now we're ready. Can you hear the like, like it is so mechanical in here. Because everything's just coming through this. You do have a sound system, by the way. Don't know if we, can't remember if we spoke about that before or not. Bill sound system, which actually, surprisingly, we have used and is pretty good. That was one of the biggest surprises for me. It's really not that bad, the sound system. Right, so out of town, here we go. Satisfying gear change, cue that. It's so special, that. Right, cue sun. Now, and cue some acceleration. Whoa. You are very quickly going very quickly in this. So 500 horsepower. Oh, can you hear that lift though? It is so special. And do you see what I mean? How you just hear the engine. You don't hear like exhaust. It's just engine and gear shift. And the brake pedal is so special. It's one of the things you notice the most when you get into this at first. It is so hard and race car like. You need to stamp with all your weight on this pedal, but it will thank you for it. This car will give you back what you give it. So if you push it hard, it will give it to you. If you need aero grip, it's got it. If you need aero grip, it's got it. If you need mechanical grip, it's got it. If you want to brake hard and you put that power into it, it will brake hard. So it will, basically, the car's telling you, I'm as good as you're going to be to me. And that's what's special. And that's, I think, where you can really tell, you know, real driver's cars from one another, is a real driver's car should give you what you give it in return. And it shouldn't be too easy, shouldn't be too simple. And you need to extract what you can out of it. And that's exactly what this car is. I mean, it has so much power. 500 horsepower. I mean, it's a lot of horsepower, right? But in today's world, actually, the crazy thing is, so there's kind of this horsepower race where 500, you get, like, my M3 has 500 horsepower, right? But there is a big difference between 500 horsepower in my M3 and 500 horsepower in this 1,100 kilo race car. It just takes off. And it's what's nice about it, too, is it's torquey. So you can be in quite a high gear, right? So look, I can be in third gear here. And the car will pull away pretty quickly and then you take off. So the power is accessible. It's not like a GT3 RS or something where you're having to rev it all the way up to 9,000 and like squeeze every last bit out of it. And the power feels almost inobtainable because it's all the way up there. Here, the power is right there. When you want it, bosh, there it is. Yeah, it's a very, very satisfying car to drive. And obviously you just have so much grip. I mean, there's no way we're even gonna get anywhere near the limits of this thing's grip. And we're not even on like the sportiest, grippiest tires that you can option for this. Oh, oh, that's addictive. It is so addictive, this car. So you get onto a small road like this, and surprisingly actually, some cars, and this is what my worry was when I first got into this, some cars which are so race focused somewhat fall apart when you end up on a little twisty road like this, because they're too track, they're built for a track and nothing else, right? Now this was literally built for a track, but somehow the wizards at KTM have managed to engineer road appliance, let's call it, into this. So it's not so hard that, I mean, when you hit bumps, you obviously feel them and you can feel everything that's going through, that's happening on the road, sorry. And your steering wheel just feels like a translator of what's happening on the road. And it's the wheels, the tires that are doing the translating. But somehow, when you then push on it, it's able to just welcome the bumps and not fall apart on them because it's so rigid that it's just skipping and jumping all over the place and feeling uncontrollable because it's just too rigid. It fills you with confidence almost because it's welcoming those bumps in a way and able to absorb them and put its power down and actually become like a back road cruncher, which is pretty amazing. So, you know, on track, this car will be as stiff and as rigid as you like to be able to throw it out. I mean, there is no body roll. I mean, body roll does not exist, at least not on the roads that I've been driving it on. Sometimes you'll get into a race car, it's almost like too much. It's too intimidating and it's too hard. So you're kind of fighting the steering wheel because you're going over bumps and the car feels like it's trying to rip away from you. Whereas here, you're not really getting any of that. So the amazing thing with this car, you guys tell me what you think. When I first saw the videos, I was like, wow, this thing looks like it has insane road presence. And I didn't know KTM were making this. To be honest, I just wasn't really aware of the car. And then when I saw it for the first time in person, I was like, this is like hypercar presence, especially this one with the full carbon spec. It's pretty incredible. Yeah, the road presence, so with the door, with the full carbon, then you can spec it however you want. These are like hypercar things. And after having spent 2 days with it, honestly, I feel like I've spent 2 days driving around in a hypercar. I genuinely feel like this makes you feel like you're in a hypercar. So let's talk about the price. The price is in euros, 320,000 euros starting price. So that's excluding options. And you know, the options are pretty hefty on this because you can go full carbon fiber and you can basically spec it however you want. That feels hypercar-esque, right? A hypercar for me is, I mean, it's so many things. It's rarity, which this car has. It's being able to personalize it exactly how you want it. So 400,000 colors. You can choose exactly how transparent you want your carbon fiber to be. You can spec the text on your calipers. You can spec the calipers. You can spec the color of your springs, all of the Alcantara inside, everything. You can really have it. So basically, none of these that will come out of the factory will be the same. Effectively, every single one's basically going to be a one-off. You have the rarity, you have the performance. I mean, I struggle to think of that many cars, even almost in the hypercar category, that on track or on a B road will be able to punch out the numbers that this thing's punching out. And then the way it makes you feel. I mean, I am surrounded by a carbon fiber cockpit. Out of these cameras, I can just catch a glimpse of green carbon fiber all over the place. When I shift gears, there's the most quality gear shift that I've ever felt in my life. It makes you feel like you're in a hypercar, right? So, whilst 320,000 euros starting price is a lot of money, right, for any car, what you now get in that price range, for some companies, they're entry-level supercars, right? You'll get a 296. You'll get a Hurricane, you know, the latest Hurricanes. You'll get a, 750S. Cars like that, which, yes, are obviously more usable, but they don't make you feel the way this car makes you feel. So if it's to go to a racetrack, if it's to take it out on a Sunday, I mean, it almost feels like you've got a hypercar sat in the garage. You're certainly not going to pull up at a traffic light in somewhere like Monaco, central London, central Paris, and show up and have another one next to you at the traffic light. So yeah, I don't know. It gives me hypercar feelings. I know it's missing certain hypercar, let's call it attributes, which will maybe be, you know, 1,000 horsepower, a naturally aspirated V12, things like that. So yeah, I mean, it has all of those things. And when we drive it around town now, it's the kind of car that if you bump into a young car spotter, they are going to literally go crazy about, like they would for a hypercar. Everyone who sees it's like, what is this thing? And I honestly just wasn't aware of this car as much as I feel now that I've driven it, feel that I should have been. Now that I've spent time with it, I'm like, wow, this, I feel like it's just come out of nowhere and is is unreal. I mean, I have really, really enjoyed my time here. So, obviously, if you had to talk about like flaws and some negatives, which all cars have, the only thing you could really fault it for is being too hardcore. But as I said, when you drive it around town, it's actually surprisingly usable. I don't know how it feels that way. It kind of shrinks around you. I mean, the only thing is, I would say maybe the cameras take some getting used to, the size of the car. You know, it's fairly wide and you're sat almost in what feels like a central driving position because you're so far in the middle of it. So maybe that takes a bit of getting used to, but I mean, any car of this type that has this kind of performance now, most of the time will have aspects of that to it. And that's why you buy this car. I mean, you're not buying this car or spending time in this car because you want it to be usable. You're buying it because it's an event, because you're gonna go set lap times on a racetrack, because you want something different, probably because you've already got those other supercars sat in your garage. And it fills a gap that not many other cars can. So, yeah, I mean, I really struggle to floor it, honestly. It's been spectacular, and I'm so happy that it exists. I'm so happy that cars like this are still being made, because, you know, in the era of just trying to make everything have less character almost is what it feels like sometimes. You know, just rip all the character out of these cars, make them as efficient as possible, and, you know, a 0-60 time, and that's all we really care about. This just feels more genuine than that. This is like, we're obviously gonna try and make it really quick, and the numbers are important, whether that's 0-60 or whatever. You know, the 0-60, we haven't even really spoken about the 0-60. It's 3.4 seconds, but it almost feels like, who cares? It makes you feel, it's what it like, it pulls out of a B road like we were on earlier, which is important. You know, the 0-60, there's plenty of cars that have a better 0-60 than this. But if you end up on that road that we were on earlier, those cars aren't gonna be able to keep up with this, you know? So that's why it almost feels irrelevant, the 0-60 number. It doesn't even feel like something you necessarily need to talk about at first. So yeah, it's an amazing car that will bring out the best or the worst of you when you're driving it. But that's what I feel like a car like this should be. It shouldn't be too easy. It should have character, and it should make you feel special. And that all those boxes are ticked with this car. So yeah, KTM, it's come out of nowhere, it feels like. It's inspired from the GT2 car. It's a race car which was put on the road, but somehow was almost made better when being put on the road. I need to test drive the race car to figure it out, but KTM, if you're looking at this, maybe one day. But it's been an absolute pleasure to be able to film this video, drive this car. I hope you've enjoyed it. I hope I haven't forgotten anything. There's so many things to cover when it's a totally new product like this. But yeah, thank you to KTM. Thank you to DRM Motors World, who have organized for me to be able to spend time with this. If you are interested in one in Europe, contact them. It's an amazing car, and they'll be able to walk you through all of the details of it. It's a new product, it's a new type of car for a lot of people, so you kind of want to be walked through the whole process. Anyways, guys, hope you've enjoyed this video. I've certainly enjoyed making it for you, and I'll see you next time. Take care. Bye-bye.